Welcome back to the Secure Future Initiative Tech Tip Show. This is the show where we talk to Microsoft experts about applying learnings from Microsoft's Secure Future Initiative. My name's Sarah Young. I'm a principal security advocate, and I'm joined by my co-host, Michael Howard, who is a senior director on the Microsoft Red Team. And today's guest is Javier. Javier, do you want to introduce yourself?
Of course. Hello. Hello, Sarah. Hello, Michael. So my name is Javier Soriano. I'm a principal product manager in the Microsoft Sentinel and Microsoft Defender XDR engineering team.
So in this episode, we're talking about enabling audit logs for cloud and also developing threat detections. So it sounds like a bit of a flippant comment, but I'm a huge fan of audit because it's part of the three golden rules of security, which are authentication, authorization, and audit. And the reason why they're called the golden rules is because they all start with AU, which I do realize is an absolutely terrible cybersecurity pun, but it is important. So Javier, you know, what sort of things do we need to collect when we're considering audit?
So everything that you can, right? So basically we can start with your cloud environment. In our case, we're going to show you in a few minutes how to do it, for example, for your Azure estate, right? So we have a series of tools in the Azure cloud that allows you to enforce that everything is audited from all the different services that you deploy in the cloud, right? And that can also expand to other places, right? Your Microsoft 365 environment, your AWS environment, your GCP environment. So all those different tools and cloud environments can be fully audited. So your analysts, your security teams can have a full audit trail of everything that has been happening in your environment for the last few months, even years, or at decades. So anytime that new threat happens in your environment, you can go back, dig all those logs, be able to find any specific occasion where a specific indicator of compromise can be found in there, and then raise alerts and be able to demonstrate where the specific attack happened and how can it be stopped.
Cool. Now, Javier, I know you're going to show us something because we always like to see something in real life on the show. So let's have a look and tell us and walk us through what you're doing here.
Perfect. So I'm here in the Azure portal, as you probably are familiar with it. Specifically, I'm in the Azure Policy section in the Azure portal. Basically, the Azure Policy engine allows you to enforce compliance with specific definitions that you apply, right? So the definitions can be standard definitions from a specific regulations like CIS or FedRAMP or any other out there or ISTO. And we have basically definitions put in place in the Azure Policy engine, so you can just rely on them, right? So I'm going to go straight to definitions here on the left, and you'll see that I have a bunch of things here, right? I'm not going to go to explain every one of them, of course, but I'm going to be jumping to one specific one, right? I'm going to go to built-in definitions, again, the ones that come out of the box. And then I'm going to switch to the specific ones that are initiatives. We have two types. Policies are single compliance rules, and initiatives are basically a group of policies, right? So I'm going to switch to initiatives only. Here you'll see that the list is pretty long, right? And as I was saying, you have things like CIS, Canada Federal, ISO, APRA, and so on and so forth. But in this case, we want to focus on something very specific, right? As we mentioned, we want to audit everything that we have in the environment. So how do we do that, right? I want to look for log analytics. Just so you know, log analytics is a log repository, basically a bucket of logs that we can enable in Azure that will basically allow me to do advanced analytics on top of the data that I collect. Specifically, you see that I have here a bunch of different initiatives that are related to log analytics. This last one looks very interesting. Right? It's telling me, hey, enable all logs category group resource login for all the supported resources to log analytics. What does this mean? That is going to enforce all my Azure resources to send all the diagnostics logs into my log analytics workspace, into my bucket of logs, right?
So the reason we do that, if I'm not mistaken, is so that whenever anybody creates a resource in Azure, that means automatically the policy applies and it will start sending logs. You don't have to turn it on manually.
Correct. There's multiple types of Azure policies, but this one specifically that we're looking at here, it does what you said, right? Doesn't matter if the person that is creating that resource forgets about enabling auditing, because this policy will enforce that the auditing is enabled always, right?
Yeah, that's a really important point there. In fact, I'm just a huge fan of Azure Policy. And by Azure Policy, I mean capital P policy. Is for exactly that, right? If you put a policy in place and you say, you know, we're going to audit things, then the auditing gets done and it removes substantially the potential for human error, like not turning audit logs on. But I have one question for you. So my old stomping ground is the Azure data team. And obviously we have things like, you know, Azure SQL database. So if I turn on auditing for Azure SQL database, is that data going to get all, you know, sucked up into all of this data as well?
Yeah, so basically someone from your team creates a new Azure SQL database. It will be enforced that that specific instance of SQL is enabled to send the logs into the workspace, indeed, into my bucket of logs. So you can see here that there's multiple examples, right? Like data lake analytics resources, database for MySQL, for MariaDB, IoT hubs, Cosmos DBs, event grids, everything, every single Azure resource that supports sending logs to log analytics will be enabled by default with this single initiative, right? If I apply, if I assign, in this case, it's called assigning an initiative to my subscription or to my management group in Azure, to my Azure environment, everything that is created in that environment will be by default enabled for this auditing.
Nice. So what do we do next then, Javier?
Yeah, so this is, again, one of the things that that we can do, right? Again, all the logs from these different resources will go into my Microsoft Sentinel and my log analytics environment. What can we do there? We can enable rules, right? So Sentinel allows me to enable rules on top of the data, so I can alert whenever something suspicious happens, right? Let's switch to my Defender portal. This is where we manage now Sentinel. As you can see here, is the SIEM and XDR console. And we have here a specific menu for Microsoft Sentinel, right? And within that, we have analytics, right? If we jump to analytics, I will be able to define a series of different rules that can be run on top of the workspace. So I have here my templates. I have a very big list of templates that I can enable. These come out of the box from the Microsoft Sentinel marketplace, and they can apply to things that we were just talking about, right? Like Azure Activity Resources, Azure SQL Resources. You can also see here third-party vendors like McAfee's, VMware, et cetera. So all those things I can enable to log their audit logs into Sentinel, so then I can apply detections that are, again, coming out of the box, or I can write my own custom detections if I want.
Now, so what you're saying is that even if you don't know, well, if you're using Sentinel, with all the out-of-the-box things, you don't need to know any, you can just use out-of-the-box, you don't have to write your own. So you can do this with relatively little knowledge to get going?
That's correct. So, for example, this one specifically, it's coming from one of our solutions, and it's identifying IP addresses, performing DNS lookups associated with Tor proxies, right? So this one came completely out of the box. I didn't have to change anything. It comes here with the specific query definition, and I just have to enable it, and it will be active in my system and runs a specific schedule. In this case, I think it runs every day in this case. And it will alert whenever something matches this definition that is provided.
And, nice. And by matches, in this particular example, you're saying something where traffic has come from a Tor proxy?
Correct. That's correct.
And yes. What else can you do with the data, Javier? Because we're doing the alerting here, but I know there's other things that we can do in terms of threat detection as well.
That's correct. So let me jump really quickly to data connectors. This is what you use to bring data from other different places, right? I'm going to here look for threat intelligence, right? And you can see that we have a bunch of connectors here that are related to threat intelligence. So because I can bring my TI, my indicators of compromise, into the Microsoft Sentinel environment. So for example, I have one connector that is for taxi servers, right? If you're familiar with taxi, it's just a specific protocol that can be used to communicate with taxi servers and bring IOCs or indicators of compromise into my environment, but also can use just the Defender Threat Intelligence connector, which comes for free. So you don't have to have a Defender for Threat Intelligence license to use this connector, and it will bring into the Sentinel workspace all those different IOCs published by Microsoft Defender for Threat Intelligence.
Hell yeah.
Yes.
If anyone doesn't know what an IOC is, do you want to just explain real briefly, just in case anyone who's tuning in doesn't know?
So basically, it's a piece of information that identifies a specific, that is identified or is associated with a specific attack, right? Imagine, for example, Log4j. Folks in the audience might be familiar with Log4j, a specific threat that happened a couple of years ago or 3 years ago. And there's a specific indicators that can be associated with that, with an attack trying to exploit the Log4j vulnerability. What can that be? It can be, for example, a file hash, right? A file that a specific attacker is using to exploit that vulnerability, and that we have the hash and we can see if that hash is present in our logs, right? That's one of them. Another one is, for example, IP address. An IP address might be used by a specific threat actor, and we can identify whenever that IP address is appearing, is showing in our logs, right? Others can be file names and things like that.
So what we'd be doing is we'd be taking these IOCs and then matching them to things in our logs potentially. And then you'd say, oh, that looks, could be bad because we already know that IP address or that hash is known to be bad. So then we can start to investigate more, right?
Correct, correct. But the first step is basically bringing those IOCs into Sentinel, which is with this connector, for example, right? Or from any other TI or threat intelligence source that you might have. And then the next step is just enabling a rule that basically matches those IOCs with your logs, right? Your logs from DNS, from your firewalls, from your endpoints, from your other cloud providers, from your SaaS applications. Any of those logs can be subject to matching with a TI source.
Can you show us some rules that have some TI? Can you show us this in action?
Absolutely, absolutely. So let me go back to analytics. I think I should be able to show you something. So I'm going to go to active rules. And here I have a specific rule that, as you can see, I filter by rule type threat intelligence. We have one specific rule, which is this one, which is called Microsoft Defender Threat Intelligence Analytics. The beauty of this rule is that it automatically does the job for you, right? I don't have to write anything. It automatically will match my event logs with the IOCs coming from Microsoft Threat Intelligence, as you can see here in the definition description of this rule. If I go to edit it, you will see that I don't have many options because it's automatically doing that for me, right? I can just review and create, and that's it. And whenever there is a match between those IOCs being brought by Defender for TI and my logs, it will raise an incident for me that I will see in my regular incident queue in the Defender portal. So it will basically show up as an incident that that is coming from this role, and it will give me the detail of what a specific IOC has been seen in the logs.
Well, yeah, I suppose I have one question. I mean, my guess is more IOCs, the more confidence you have that something is a real attack, right? As opposed to something happening accidentally.
Correct, right? So you can basically have multiple layers, right, of controls, right? Right? One thing is that I see an isolated IOC, but then the great thing that we have in the Defender ecosystem is that there will be multiple signals that are correlated with each other. So there might be one signal coming from Sentinel saying, hey, we've seen an IOC that is tagged as malicious in your logs. But then also we see another activity coming from, for example, from Defender for Endpoint, from my EDR solution, right? And then if those two specific alerts can be correlated together because maybe they affect the same host or because maybe the same user is related to both alerts, they will be correlated together into a higher severity incident that then the analyst can investigate further, right? But for sure, like one IOC being matched in your logs is sometimes not enough to trigger a high severity investigation. But when that is correlated to other signals coming from, again, endpoint, from my email protection service, from my CASB solution, like Defender for Cloud Apps in our case, from my Defender for Cloud or Cloud Workload Protection service. So all of those signals can be correlated together by the XDR intelligence that is built in Defender XDR.
Yeah, a lot of that data also comes from my sister team, right? The Mystic team, the Microsoft Threat Intelligence team.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yep.
Nice. Well, Javier, I think That is a nice little foray into doing logs and auditing. So I guess takeaways would be make sure you actually turn on auditing and get those logs in one place. Make sure that they are in a central space altogether so you can run analytics. And make sure you put some threat intelligence across it. And of course, if you're using Sentinel, you can use all the built-in detections.
Hey, I want to add something. Just remember the other golden rule that doesn't start with AU though. Collection is not detection, right? Just collecting logs doesn't buy you anything if you're not doing the work over those logs.
Yeah, you're right. I know. Well, Javier, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate your time. And for everyone who's tuning in, thanks for joining us for Secure Future Initiative Tech Tips. And we'll see you on another episode.